Time is always moving forward, sometimes so fast that we don't realize it. And this rule applies to both living things, planets, and stars. But have you thought about how much the Earth can change in millions of years? What will it look like in 10, 100, 500, or even 1 billion years? The world we know will certainly have changed forever, but how much is known about that distant future? What might a sunrise look like then? And what future will humanity have? What would the Earth look like 100 million years from now? A temporal perspective. First, we have to gain some perspective on the amount of time we're handling. It's easy to imagine how much 10 years are, even to imagine events that occurred between about 80 and 100 years ago, such as the Second World War, the Great Depression of 1929. Thanks to history, we can know things that happened thousands of years ago, with a world very similar to the current one, but with very different cultures and civilizations. And that's where the easy part ends. It is thought that the human being is, in his facet of modern man, between 10,000 and 12,000 years of existence. The large mammals of prehistory, such as the mammoth, the glyptodont, giant armadillo, the megatherium, giant sloth, and the smilodon, better known as the saber-toothed tiger, inhabited the Earth in the Pleistocene epoch between 12,000 and 2.6 million years ago. The ancestors of humanity separated from the evolutionary line of chimpanzees about 7 million years ago. On the other hand, the ancestors of mammoths can be traced back to 34 million years, and of course, a famous event is the extinction of the dinosaurs 65 million years ago. However, the Mesozoic period dominated by dinosaurs lasted from 252 million years until its tragic end 65 million years ago, lasting 187 million years. So a T-Rex is much closer to us in time than the first dinosaurs. Back then, the Earth was very different. Dinosaurs were born under the cradle of the supercontinent Pangea, which is thought to have formed about 325 million years ago and was divided 175 million years ago into a continental drift that has led to the world as we know it geographically today. The supercontinent cycle. Pangea, meaning all lands, form practically in a single hemisphere, spanning all latitudes from the North Pole to the South Pole. Still, it was a single massive continent surrounded by a single ocean, Panthalassa, or All Seas. As you are undoubtedly thinking, this configuration had significant implications for the climate, marine currents, and the biosphere itself, being a condition for the evolution and distribution of flora and fauna. The union and separation of the continental masses are known as the supercontinent cycle. Although there has been much debate to the dates on which the supercontinents have formed, there is much confidence that there have been at least four other supercontinents in addition to Pangea, as explained by R. Damian Nance of the Department of Geological Sciences at Ohio University in his article, The Cycle of Supercontinents. These four supercontinents and their estimated periods of existence are Penosha from 620 to 580 million years, Rodinia from 950 to 800 million years, Nuna or Columbia from 1600 to 1400 million years, and Kennerland from 2700 to 2500 million years. Haven't there been more supercontinents? It may be, but records in rocks are challenging to assemble globally to figure out at those timescales, partly because of the same principle that forms them, plate tectonics, both builds and destroy the planet's geology slowly. Even so, this means that in 1 billion years, evidence of three supercontinents have been found. So we already have a good idea of how far in time we are going towards the future. However, it is still a short time if we put it in a planetary or stellar perspective. The effects of the Sun on Earth. The Earth has approximately 4.6 billion years of having formed, having an age very similar to the Sun, a G-type star or yellow dwarf that is on its main sequence. There are about 5.5 billion years before it begins to become a red giant that could swallow the Earth in its expansion, a process that in turn can take about 1 billion years by itself. However, our wonderful star is not going to stay exactly as it is now during those 5.5 billion years left within its main sequence. Oh no. In fact, it is thought that every 100 million years that pass, its luminosity increases by 1% and also increases its radius a little. This may not seem like much, but it means that long before it becomes a red giant, the Sun's luminosity will be so intense that it will eliminate life on Earth as we know it. Looking to the future is much more complex than it seems. Still, it is thought that the increase in the luminosity of the sun, and therefore in the temperature of the Earth, will gradually evaporate the water of the seas. It is expected that in about 900 million or 1 billion years, the temperature on the planet will begin to evaporate Earth's surface water, creating a wet greenhouse effect that will make life as we know it today impossible. Under this future, possible climate scenarios are meaningless. The planet will have a lot of humidity in its atmosphere, but with temperatures so high that they will completely change the conditions for life as we know it. So the evolution of complex organisms may not have much time left on our planet, including us humans. This dramatic change in the atmosphere implies that the Earth will be a humongous hell, distributing its temperature regardless of the cycle of day and night, more similar to how Venus is today than to how Mercury is, where this cycle does generate hellish days at 430 degrees Celsius, with frosty nights of minus 180 degrees Celsius. So, on the future Earth 1 billion years from now, exceptionally bright sunrises are expected, but they will increase the temperature relatively little compared to night, being hostile to humanity permanently. The loss of water, oxygen, and life as we know it. These conditions will lower atmospheric pressure and bring water vapor closer and closer to the stratosphere or beyond, where its molecules will be reached by UV rays and through photolysis processes will break off hydrogen atoms that could escape into space, denying that water molecule from forming again, causing the oceans to escape into space slowly, as explained by the University of Cambridge in the book Heliophysics, Evolution of Solar Activity, Space Weather, and the Earth. The loss of the oceans can take between 1 to 3 billion years, either by the mechanism of the wet greenhouse effect or by the unstoppable increase in the sun's luminosity. However, it is not the only catastrophic process for the atmosphere and the biosphere because many delicate cycles will not survive these changes, and that can even be interrupted long before the billion-year mark, such is the case of the cycle of silicates and carbon dioxide, the production of oxygen, and even plate tectonics, although this last issue does depend on the disappearance of the oceans. Let's go in parts. Researchers Kazumi Ozaki and Christopher T. Reinhard think that as the sun increases the temperature on the Earth's surface, the rate of weathering of silicates will increase dramatically, which in turn will favor a drop in atmospheric CO2 by reacting to these physical and chemical processes, being transported from the atmosphere to the hydrosphere and being captured by deposition on the seafloor. This process may start from somewhere within the next 500 million years. It could lead to such a drastic drop in atmospheric CO2 that it could generate a mass extinction of organisms that survive thanks to photosynthesis, from all kinds of plants to photoplankton, which in turn would lead to the extinction of oxygen in the atmosphere, an extremely severe condition for life. In their work, The Future Lifespan on Earth's Oxygenated Atmosphere, they comment that once a critical point of parts per million of CO2 in the atmosphere is reached, the deoxygenation process will be very fast at geological and even evolutionary scales, estimating that it will occur within about 10,000 years. In turn, this deoxygenation of the Earth favors the extinction of the ozone layer and the entry of a more significant amount of harmful radiation for the planet's life. A scenario not encouraging will increase the speed with which the planet will lose its oceans in space. The future of plate tectonics. On the other hand, it is thought that when the end of the oceans arrive, a significant impact will be generated in the tectonics of plates, which are supported in part by the lower melting points of rocks at the convergent or destructive boundary. If the water vanishes from the surface, then the rocks that are in their subduction path to the mantle will no longer be hydrated, and this could lead to the subduction stop, changing the balance of total forces in the tectonic plates and stopping their normal process of creation and destruction. This is still in high debate, so it should be taken with caution. Still, the end of plate tectonics implies the end of global geographical changes and the end of the cycle of silicates and CO2, since the latter will not return to the mantle and be released by volcanism. It will be a different Earth from the one we know. Another event that will eventually come will be the cooling of the outer core, which is thought to stop the planet's interior dynamo and stop the Earth's magnetic field. However, it is still very difficult to know when it will pass, with estimates between 3 to 5 billion years. It is curious to think that if the plate tectonics stop, it will favor a slower end for our geomagnetic field. For what we have seen, it would be easy to say that in 1 billion years, another 3 supercontinents may be created and separated. But we do not have the necessary tools to make such a claim. NASA itself has put supercomputers to try to understand the future of movements of the Earth's crust. However, the results are varied, and it has only been possible to visualize about 200 to 300 million years in the future. Researchers Matthias Green, Hannah Sophia Davies, and Joao C. Duarte estimate that there could be 4 possible configurations of supercontinents, being Novo Pangea, Pangea Ultima, Orica, and Mesa. The most likely scenario being that of Novo Pangea, which would locate all landmasses relatively close to the equator, something that could contribute to the increase in global temperature. However, despite many computational and theoretical efforts, little more has been possible to go into the future in this regard. Imagine that only about 250 million years in the future implies such uncertainty that 4 possible scenarios are on the table. Possible destinies of humanity. And well, with all these difficulties, what does it hold for humanity 1 billion years from now? Keep in mind that in that period, all possible catastrophes may have occurred, from planet-killing asteroids, the dreaded massive volcanic explosion of Yellowstone, to a nearby gamma-ray explosion that can't sterilize the planet, not to mention the wars over political instability or natural resources and the infamous nuclear winters. This will lead to never-before-seen challenges for our species that have been explored extensively in science fiction and post-apocalyptic universes, so it is more likely that we will no longer be here after so long. However, the fact that people are working to know these dark scenarios, together with the fact that life is not easy to eradicate, opens the hope that many of the challenges we have known so far have some proposals for a solution through geoengineering, biotechnology, or genetics, although these solutions also have profound ethical implications. Most likely, if we have not self-destructed during the journey of the next billion years, humanity will find a method for interstellar travel. Mars would be an exciting intermediate because as the sun increases its luminosity, it will move its habitable zone and be relatively easy to terraform in a few hundred million years. Despite all this, whether we find ways to stay stronger on Earth or fly fast, one thing is sure, our destiny is in the stars.